everyone, welcome to Bad Toons. I'm Chris.
I'm Andy.
And we are back again for what may be a disastrous episode of Bad Toons. This is Patreon Picks number 2, where we let our Patreon supporters pick the tunes that we watch. And boy, have they let us down. Guys, come on. It's like you're trying to kill this fucking show. Is there a word for that when you give charitable donations as an act of sabotage? Our good pal Gerald Watercrest, he's a longtime listener. He suggested this cartoon.
Hey guys, this is Gerald, or John, or Geralt, or whatever you'd like to call me. So for my bad tune, I've decided to pick the Elm-Chanted Forest. It's an animated film from the mid-80s. I believe it's either Croatian or Yugoslavian. And the reason I decided to pick this very interesting and enchanting tale is just for the simple fact that growing up, unfortunately, my hometown's cable company didn't have a lot of choices. They did have Disney Channel, however, and they played the Elm-Chanted Forest nonstop. So I hope you are ready to jump into the world of Peter Pallet and the Fifi the Fox, hedgehogs, a little black mage named Thistle, frogs, and there's also a fire elemental. I'm going to stop spoiling it. Thank you.
Our friend Cylo, first Cylo requested that we do Clerks the cartoon series. Now, I am an avid opponent of Kevin Smith.
He protests all of his movies for some reason. He goes out there with picket signs.
Down with this sort of thing. But I do enjoy Clerks the cartoon series. I think of Kevin Smith's works,
best thing he's ever done.
It's the best thing he's ever done, and it's because he didn't technically write it alone. There's a staff of writers working on it. But when I told him, hey, I don't want to do a cartoon that I've seen a bunch and that I actually like, well, I guess that might have offended him, because then he pitched, how do you pronounce this? Ctrl+Alt+Del. Ctrl+Alt+Del.
So is Del the funky Homo sapien in this?
Maybe. Maybe it's the dude you're getting a Del guy, like the animated adventures of. I mean, Johnny English got a movie, so why not? Oh, you know what? I believe that actually stands for Ctrl+Alt+Delete, the animated series based off of the infamous webcomic, I think is... No, it's not a webcomic of Infamous.
There probably have been some Infamous comics. It's a video game
But
comic.
Those were probably made by Penny Arcade. It's a webcomic that is reviled, I guess is a way of putting it. And he did this just to punish us. However, I don't think he noticed they're only 3 minutes long each.
Yeah, so we're going to watch more than one.
There's a 5-minute runtime. But when you take out the intro and the credits, you get about 3 minutes of actual cartoon. We could just watch one and be done with it.
No.
This could be the shortest segment we've ever done.
What if we watch...
Ctrl+Delete! It's garbage! Good night, everybody!
We watch all of them. And then we only review one.
Why would we do that?
So that we act like, oh, we only watched one episode, but really we watched all of them. Because Cylo paid good money. Or was it bad money? Did he sell drugs for this? Did he, like, take out a hit on somebody?
That is the ultimate crime, is to sell drugs to children in order to get some people online to review the Ctrl+Alt+Delete web cartoon. I'm sure that would probably add on to his sentence, if anything. He might be swinging from the gallows when we're done. And then finally, Mace Stampede, another longtime supporter of ours, he suggested a cartoon that cannot be named. There have been some smatterings on the internet that while reviewing or making parody videos or even talking about certain 3D animated cartoons that may or may not share similarities with popular Pixar or DreamWorks films, that people's channels have been completely taken down. DMCA takedowns, content ID strikes, and just complete removal of channels. So this might be the ultimate act of sabotage in the guise of a charitable donation.
Hold on, Chris.
Yes.
Can we take a break from the podcast for a second?
Yeah.
Okay, I know there's There's a Pokemon named Raticate. What's the other rat Pokemon? It's Rattata, right?
Yeah, Rattata.
Rattata. Okay, cool. I just wanted to clear that up. Wait, actually, hold on. One more question. What band was Danny Elfman in?
Oingo Boingo.
Okay. That answers my two questions.
That's just weird that you want to know about Rattata and Oingo Boingo.
That answers my two questions.
Anyway, so it's a movie that we're back from our break.
We're watching Forbidden Zone.
We're watching Forbidden Zone. Richard Elfman with appearance by Danny Elfman. And Hervé Villechaize is in it. So that's something. So yeah, so let's jump into this minefield of litigation, complaints, and terrible animation.
Sugarloaf Mountain, overlooking Rio de Janeiro, where the most famous restaurant belongs to a mouse? Meet Marcel Toing, proud owner of restaurant Ratatouille. Chef Toing knows the secret of every great chef. To prepare the most delicious meals, you must find the freshest ingredients.
So a man walks into a talent agency, and he walks over to the head agent, and he says, I have an act that the people are just going to love. And the head agent says, go ahead, show me the act. He goes, okay. And he pulls out a DVD copy of Ratatouille, and he puts it on the ground. And he takes a big steaming shit on it. And then he gets 15 Brazilian animators to come in, and they take a shit on it. And then he gets a gaggle of anime voice actors, and they take a shit on it. And they take a huge steaming shit on this movie. And the agent looks up and goes, what do you call this trick? And the man says,
the aristocrats?
The aristocrats?
That is what we get with, yet again, the movie we can't name.
Ratatouille.
You just named it.
I'm going to have to edit out the name. I'm going to have to maybe flip the animation and maybe discolor it even, because I'm so scared of them taking this video down, because there have been rumors they've done it before. We've seen this pop up with many YouTubers. We've seen it with other cartoon reviewers. YouTube poopers used to use this as a source.
And YouTube actually has new guidelines.
Mm-hmm.
And it says, you know, oh, no violence, no excessive cursing, all that kind of stuff. What if you read between the lines, it's really saying no rat-tattooing.
This movie is based on the award-winning trailer for Ratatouille. This is this comes from the tradition of animated films by really low-budget studios, a lot of them foreign, aping off of popular movies at the time. This has been around since the Disney Renaissance, and it's probably not going to go away. But the people who made this obviously didn't watch all of Ratatouille, because it's like, yeah, a rat has a restaurant, he steals food, whatever. Wait, shit, how's he steal the food? It's probably some kind of James Bond-esque heist.
I think you mean Rat Bond.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. Rat Bond.
They're like super secret agents. You should check out their equipment. It reminds me of a Rat Bond movie.
Because that's a pun, I think.
So
it's a play on words, on James Bond, Rat Bond. Not James Pond. That's an actual pun.
This movie opens with the narration. It's talking about Marcel Toing, owner of the famous Ratatouille.
Ratatouille. The marvelous city. Land of sun and heat. With one of the most beautiful urban skylines in the world. This is a prosperous city. That's where our story takes place. In the heart of this city, in a very famous and sophisticated restaurant, frequented by the most notable residents of the city, Ratatouille. The favorite bistro, according to the truly sophisticated and refined rats.
Which is a restaurant that rats go to. And the food is great. The rats love this food. Let me tell you how much these rats love this food. They spend 11 goddamn minutes out of this 40-minute film talking about how great the food is. I kept writing down, Jesus Christ, we're 2 minutes in, and they're still talking about how great this restaurant is. 2 minutes became three. Three became six. Six became seven. Then nine. Then finally, the 11-minute mark is when they introduce, like, the first plot point. It is all people ordering food and being like, oh, I knew this was a good restaurant, but I couldn't imagine it was this great. And
I think Sweary made this. All they did was talk about the fucking food.
They have these disgusting malformed mouths that flap and undulate with no real attempt to look like an actual organic being. When their mouths are wide open, some of the characters just, their standard static pose for the model is mouth agape. And you can see the pair of teeth just floating in a sea of blackness. It is so disturbing. It is like a model for a PS1 game that hasn't loaded right. It is like when you push Lara Croft against a wall and you flip the camera around and you can see her eyes in the back of her head and just her fucking dentures like chomping chatter teeth clacking up and down. That's every single character. So who are our main characters, Andy? There's Marcel Toing, home of the famous Ratatouille, but who are his comrades?
No, Rio de Janeiro is home of the world-famous Ratatouille. Home of the world-famous Marcel Toing, owner and proprietor of the world-famous Ratatouille.
So who are the other characters?
Home of the freshest ingredients. I think there's... Is it Cheryl or Carol? I always get that name confused.
It's Cheryl and who else? Who's the star of the show?
Is his name Craig?
Whatever. Precisely.
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 The whole night, every time we watch something else, I would start laughing and go, precisely. Because it shows up so often in the movie.
There's a catchphrase this green rat has, the snaggletooth. Two catchphrases. One is heavy breathing with his mouth open. Several times, the model just breaks. And as I said before, his static pose is just for his mouth to just hang all the way open. And the second is him just going, precisely.
Sometimes two times a sentence.
Precisely.
Precisely. And then the other one is Sally Acorn for some reason. I don't know why she showed up. There's this one rat who's over-sexualized.
It's not Sally Acorn.
Who is it?
She's played by Amy Rose. It's Amy Rose, Chris.
Like the voice actress?
Yes. No, it's live action.
But you're not saying she looks like Amy Rose. You're saying like the voice is Amy Rose.
The voice is Amy Rose.
This movie's taking so much from me, Andy. Just gonna, I guess that waifu's going in the trash. Just stuff it down there.
Oh, God.
Man, I'm gonna have to delete some files off my hard drive tonight. Damn it.
Was it the Amy Rose porn or the Ratatouille porn?
They ruin each other. It's cross-contamination.
Oh, I love this Ratatouille movie. Until I found out Amy Rose was in it.
And her lazy eye. Remember that great scene where she attempts a wink and then turns as if she's on a lazy Susan or something that's revolving her and then she floats away. We should talk
mouth
about...
Mouth agape the whole time.
Mouth agape the whole time. We should talk about the animation in this. Or lack thereof. The mouths...
Precisely!
I don't know if the mouths... were controlled with some kind of mechanism, but the body animations are amazing. Every female rat in this movie has what I call a carnival walk. You know when you see the women at carnival and they have the big headdresses and their cleavage hanging out and they're covered in just silver and diamonds all over? They have this kind of gait to their walk where they push their hands forward, and I think it's just because the amount of jewelry they have on their arms. And maybe also they're trying to show off the goods. Every female rat walks like that. Every male rat, though, walks like he is, like, in mud. He looks like he is, like, very carefully sneaking somewhere. And this can be a character that's actually sneaking, or this could be a character of, like, hold on, I'll get your check.
I'm sorry, Chris. It is very hard for me to focus. Ever since you were talking about the... technology that they use to lip sync in a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
I just imagine test footage with Kiefer Sutherland with all the dots on his face, except it's Ratatouille next to him.
Precisely.
So the plot is these rats run a very successful restaurant that people don't fucking shut up about.
It starts with the rat, like, already being the best chef in the, you know, like, this there's no hero's journey. He's already the best.
This could be just the sequel to Ratatouille.
We couldn't go that far, but okay.
We could be missing out. I mean, the end of Ratatouille, spoiler alert, is that he opens up a restaurant. And then I guess the young couple, the human couple who run it with him, die?
Yeah.
Who knows?
The bombs drop.
So they run this restaurant, and people are going gaga because they have some kind of special ingredient. Only the freshest ingredients. And it makes their food good. And there's a conglomerate of other restaurant owners who are at the restaurant incognito who are trying to discern what this special ingredient is. And it turns out the special ingredient is that the rats sneak into a real human-owned restaurant that happens to be adjacent to their restaurant, and they steal food. And
like James Bond.
Like
how he used to sneak
Rat
in.
Bond.
I'm sorry, like Rat Bond.
Thank you.
They steal rat burgers.
Mm. No, that's Scum of the Earth. That's a different show we do.
Oh, sorry.
It's the same fucking show. We have a training montage. I actually have that in parentheses.
Those are quotation marks, you liar.
Sorry, quotation
marks. You lied to the people. Our fans are never going to forgive us.
Here's the thing. The evil villains talk about their plan. They walk out the restaurant. They walk out probably a couple feet, stop. And then for an inordinate amount of time, just talk about how their restaurant's failing. It's not as good as Ratatouille. Why is Ratatouille so much better? Well, we got to remember our plan. Our plan is to ruin Ratatouille. How are we going to ruin Ratatouille? Oh, I know. We're going to sabotage Marcel Toing. And if we take him out of the picture, then, you know, our restaurants will do better. Then it cuts to this training montage of the Ratatouille crew getting ready to go on their heist. It's all in front of a white background, so it's a Matrix parody. They do slow motion karate stunts, and they like put on their belts and their gear. One guy does martial arts with some blocks of cheese.
And it lasts an hour.
It lasts
it
a good
felt
long time.
Like it lasted an hour, but I don't know how long it actually
But then mid montage, it cuts back to the villains in the exact same spot having their evil plan. It is the most jarring cut I've ever seen in a cartoon.
I would love if the villains, like, they spend so much time having just one scene play out of the villains talking.
Yeah.
It's like fucking Quentin Tarantino directed it or some shit. I would love if they just halfway through were like, so how was your day? Like, if they just ran out of evil stuff to talk about and just kept going, and that was the whole movie.
Were they waiting for a car to pick them up?
Wait a minute.
Were they waiting for the rat bus?
This isn't a Ratatouille ripoff. This is My Dinner with Andre, but with rats.
We have some funny scenes where the big dumb green rat keeps fucking up. Precisely fucks up in the kitchen, but they get a strawberry. But while they're doing this, one of the evil rats does her little carnival sachet, sees them doing, you know, stealing food from the human kitchen. It's like, aha. And then she's like, I better get out of here before they see me. And she proceeds to walk the exact same speed away. And it makes it look like the green rat sees her, but they do nothing with that. So the evil rats, who are in the same goddamn spot. Do they live there? Do they live like a block away from Ratatouille? Is this like their haunt?
Hey, Chris, I'm going to part the kimono a little bit here.
Okay.
They only modeled two fucking locations in this movie.
Fuck you. Three.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Four of the kitchen is not considered part of the restaurant.
The kitchen, the restaurant, and in front of the restaurant, that's all one.
That's true. Oh, fuck, you're right.
There are two places.
Like, seriously, if we're doing like this as a model in a 3D animation program, you are precisely right. They have, I mean, the human kitchen is obviously, because of the scale and everything, is a different model.
But it's connected to the kitchen.
I wouldn't think so. I would think that the outside of the rat's kitchen where the rats hang out, the inside of the rat's restaurant and the rat's kitchen is one model. And then the second model, because it's so much bigger and it's using different assets of different scale, that would be a different map. And also, that's where you put your jump pads. That's where you put your warps and your items.
Well, I'm loading up Hammer right now. Okay, I see there's a little green Gordon Freeman. That's very cute.
There he is. I mean, Andy, I would if I was putting this on FPS Banana, I would have to label the human kitchen, ironically, parentheses, rats, whereas the Ratatouille restaurant would just be Ratatouille restaurant.
No, I think you mean DM _ Ratatouille restaurant.
You're right. I'm sorry.
I wish I could insta-give these rats.
So the bad rats, also available on Steam, the bad rats decide they need to sabotage. And this is actually kind of clever. To sabotage Ratatouille, they need to make it more difficult for Marcel Toing to get ingredients. And they do this by going to the human restaurant and fuck. They fuck like horny rats in a hot sack.
Okay, so
in front of all the restaurant patrons. And then they do a dance to celebrate.
I think Chris and I might have been watching different movies.
No, dude, I'm playing it right now. They are fucking.
Oh, okay.
And that is a celebratory post-coital can. But here's the thing. I guess they have bad rat problems in Brazil because no one fucking notices until they walk up, kick a woman in the shoe and go, look at us. We're rats. We're crazy.
Now, Chris pointed out while we were watching, one of the rats wears a fake mustache in the first scene. When mm-hmm. they're going to the restaurant so that no one can know who he is.
He points out. He takes the mustache off. He's like, that's why I'm incognito.
Guess what? None of the other ones do. Okay. But he does the same thing with the humans as if the humans know that rat without the mustache and he needs to be incognito for the humans.
Wait a minute.
Maybe it's the only way he can come. He's like, I gotta wear the mustache. It's the only way I can finish.
I gotta tie you up and wear the mustache, or daddy can't get his. So the humans then put down traps to stop Marcel Toing, because like, oh, we got a rat problem. We better put down some rat traps. And this does, one almost fucking takes his arms off because he's so stupid. Amy Rose is like, Toing, don't do it. Those are traps. He's like, oh, no, it's just perfectly... a perfect cube of cheese just sitting on this wooden platform, and there's hundreds of them. Nothing, and it's on the ground. I know nothing about human beings. I assume they eat off the ground like we do. Holy shit. I almost got my fucking hands chopped off. Amy, next time, can you fucking warn me with some more urgency in your voice? Precisely. Kid Muscle, you gotta do it. At that point, we get probably the best scene in the movie where Marcel Toing is attacked by a guard animal. Now, what animal, don't answer this, Andy. This is for the viewers at home. I want to paint a word picture. What animal do you think you would get if you had a rat problem? You'd get a ghoulie. Because the cat ghoulie from Ghoulies shows up. I mean,
I like to believe that this is the cat ghoulie from Ghoulie.
Mm-hmm.
Ghoulies, rather, not Ghoulie. That's the prequel that we're going to release at some point.
We did.
Oh, we did?
Yeah, it's called Ratatouille. But continue.
Oh. I like to believe that he had sex with Garfield and that their kid was this ghouly cat hybrid.
See, no. I like to imagine this is a cut scene. It was cut from the movie because it's 40 goddamn minutes long. But this entire movie is a cut scene from The Nine Lives of Garfield. And the reason why the CGI is so shit is this is the best they could do in the late 80s, early 90s. At that point, I already gave the bad rats a little too much credit when I said their plan was actually kind of brilliant. Because then they say, fuck, our restaurants still aren't doing good. What are we gonna do? Why don't we go steal the food? Oh, the food that we sabotaged with the cats and the traps? And the two chick rats are like, do it, you pussies. You fucking pussies. You losers. You need a mustache to come? Go get me some food.
You ain't got the balls.
Precisely.
Hey, why is this green rat here? He can foil our plan.
No, he's too stupid. He's in his own little world. He's standing in the corner saying precisely to precisely nobody.
I'm just imagining Greg, the green rat, staring into space. Like, they cut back to him, and he's just staring, and there's just static playing, and his mouth is open, like.
So the bad rats try a heist where they're going to stick up Amy Rose and the Green Rat with some toothpick swords. And I'm kind of upset that the guy didn't whip off his mustache and was like, it was me the whole time. Marcel Toing is distracting the cat ghoulie and has a conversation with it. And off camera convinces the cat ghoulie to join their side. And he grabs the two bad rats, and Marcel Toing is like, I'm sure your owner is going to reward you handsomely for catching the rats. And the human beings the next day are like, well, we got two rats. That means our rat problem's probably done with. That means we can take these traps off the floor. Oh, and I'm assuming that the two rats that were caught were murdered. Marcel Toing has fucking blood on his hands. Do not patronize this man's restaurant. He is a fucking murderer. Fucking restaurant. This is like that Hamlet remake that takes place in a fast food restaurant.
Waiting?
Yes. No, still waiting.
Oh, okay.
I said Hamlet, not Macbeth.
Of course.
So the movie wraps up. Everything's fine. The cat now eats at the restaurant, which I think would trouble the other patrons greatly. But my favorite thing is that The narrator comes back, who's obviously also the green rat. He's also one of the guys who works in the restaurant. They just downmix his voice. The narrator comes back and he borrows a narration style from my favorite Denzel Washington movie, Fallen. So that was a nice treat.
And soon the ratatouille was full again. Almost everything seemed to be back to normal. I said almost everything, didn't I?
Oh, you forget. I was going to tell you about the time I almost died. God. See you around.
They also, for some reason, name drop a unmade sequel to My Cousin Vinny, My Other Cousin Vinny.
It was my second cousin Vinny who told me about this great restaurant.
So, man, this just loves ripping off other movies.
Yeah.
But I'm going to say this, it's worth checking out. Of all the things we saw tonight, we laughed at this the most.
For its legendary status, like for like YouTube poops and stuff like that, it's definitely worth checking out.
But it earned it. It earned its status. This is something so bad that it's good.
And it's baffling too. It's baffling that they would choose to show a white background scene where they all get geared up, and then it goes on for like 3 minutes, and then they show it two more times.
It was almost like these were episodes of a TV show, and that was like the it's morphin' time the of most, this show, and they keep doing it.
The most poorly paced TV show, I would say.
It does fade to black for commercial breaks. Blakes.
Commercial Blake.
Hi, I'm Commercial Blake.
Oh, I was going to be Commercial Blakes.
Then we're going to have to fight, motherfucker.
I'm Commercial Jonathan Frakes. What's up? This is how Jonathan Frakes talks, y'all.
That's how Commercial Jonathan Frakes talks.
Yeah.
He got a note from Gene Roddenberry, and he was like, we can't sell the show with you talking like that.
I'm the Third Reicher. What's up? Oh, no, actually, that makes me sound like a Nazi. I meant that because there's two Rikers.
Hey, y'all, it's me. I'm the Third Riker, Billy Riker. My transport and pattern got caught up with the cowboy world. And also that Nazi world in the first Star Trek. It's a callback joke, everybody. Yeehaw, Heil Hitler. Every Bad Toons, we have to make a joke about Nazi.
That one was an accident.
So was Thomas Riker.
So... You're gonna make him cry, Chris.
But he was legit a transport malfunction.
Yeah. Guess what? We were accidents. I don't still like hearing about it.
That's true. our mom will tell us what accident. I think she was like, fuck you. You weren't.
That's what she says.
You were, no, I was alive. You were the chosen one. My mom, this is how vindictive and evil our mother is. My mom is like, Steph was the sponge and it didn't work. And you, Chris, you were a broken condom. And Hope, she of course was the pill and that didn't take. But Andy, my little precious Andy, we wanted to get one more out of the litter before your dad got his tubes tied. And she fucking throws that in our face every fucking Thanksgiving.
So I want to point out one more thing about Ratchet, this unnamed movie.
Yes.
There is a part where they're talking about the restaurant failing and all this kind of stuff. And I was wondering why the rats couldn't just talk to the humans.
Yeah.
Like kind of form a deal where they can like give them just a little bit of food.
They're speaking through the whole movie.
Yeah. But then I realized rats can't speak to humans. And I figured out why.
Oh, like a movie rule?
Yeah. Well, it's like a rule in real life, too.
Yeah.
Rats speak English. Humans speak Portuguese.
8 out of 10.
Well, I see by the clock on the wall that it's almost time for our special night work.
Hey, my handsome friend, are you ready for more adventures tonight?
I'm always ready, because I know how to keep my equipment prepared. I smell something fresh coming from down there.
That's awesome, let's go.
Guess what I found down there?
What is it?
Big, beautiful
dick.
Get down there, Marcel, hurry.
Calm down, Greg. Marcel, take your time. What have you done, you clumsy idiot? Wow, that was really fast.
Yeah, but that ain't cheese. Precisely.
Is that...
Yep.
The you're not getting any for a month look?
Yep.
Then, for the sake of the procreation of the gamer species, I'm gonna let you go now.
Good call.
This show was so bad, it makes Ratatouille look like Ratatouille. This show was so bad, it makes Dorbies look like Wally. This show is so bad, it makes the cow that almost missed Christmas Ernest Scared Stupid somehow. I don't... That's an anomaly that even I can't even
like
describe.
Literally.
Like literally.
Literally, we check the file, it's transformed.
I put it on and suddenly it's Ernest P. Worrell talking about the high ground and the people of Botswana for a very long time. But what is a very funny scene? Maybe the funniest scene of our time. Now, Ctrl+Alt+Del, for those of you who don't know, this is a cartoon based on a webcomic created by Bunt Tudley. He got a producer, a very famed producer, John T. Chick of the Chick Track fans.
Jack Chick.
Sorry, Jack Chick. Jack to his, John to his friends. Jack T. Chick produced this animated series along with the Baptist Church Association of America, I assume. Now, I could have looked this up. I could have watched the credits. But I'm just assuming that's who's behind this. Because on the surface, this looks like gaming content made for gamers. But it's more insidious than that. I think this is to warn and ward people away from the hobby of video gaming. Now, bear with me. It's going to get crazy. I'm going to explain this by looking at one episode only. And then prove my findings with two more episodes. So the hypothesis is this. When we look at the very beginning, we have a man simply asking a GameStop, Game Haven employee if Halo will work on the PS2. And he comes off as a nice guy, right?
Yeah.
Like he's just an affable dad. Maybe he doesn't know any better, you know? I mean, there are different brands of VCR, but a VHS tape's going to work in all of them. Why not? For someone who's not into the hobby, that's a very simple question to ask. And he is mercilessly ridiculed by the employee of this GameStop, Game Haven, EB Games, Babbage's, Software, etc.
Excuse me. I need to know if Halo will play on my PS2.
I'm sorry. I don't speak stupid. And our translator called out sick today.
But there's no resolution to the scene. The man just leaves claiming to never shop in the store again. Who's the main character? From the outset, who would you guess is the main character?
Why, the reasonable man who just wants to know if the game will work.
It's a very Clark Griswold kind of experience. Is you have the snotty teenage employee making... Not in a million years would I guess that this snotty-nosed brat is the main character of this show. But it made me realize that's an old Clever Jack instrument. You have the more grounded individual introduced into this scene, and morally, we are already given diametric opposites here. He's headed to church right now. That's the comic we don't see. I'm assuming that's the end of this series, is we see him, you know, he doesn't have Halo. So he just he's like, oh, what else can I do? And Jesus is there and he goes, I got a game for you. And it never ends. He's like, awesome.
I'm sorry. Jesus totally ignores the fact that the game is named Halo. He's like, here's your Halo. Shit. Or something like that. He just says, here's I got a game for you. And it's Christianity. I don't know. I'm Jesus. How would I know how to write jokes?
I'm not meant to be funny. That's not my purpose.
No, if Ctrl+Alt+Del, I'm assuming it ends with, what's the main character's name?
Ethan.
With Egon.
Yeah.
In a hospital bed, dying. Probably of a disease. Going, why did I waste my life with video games? Why didn't I believe in Jesus Christ? And then he dies and goes to hell.
That's what I'm assuming, yeah.
Yeah.
When Orton gets home, he's having an argument with his roommate because he wants to play all the brand new games that he's bought. And his roommate won't let him. His roommate is playing Dead or Alive. And he wants to play Fight Night. He's like, move over. I want to play Fight Night. His roommate's like, no, it's my day off. I was here first. I'm playing Dead or Alive. And they go through this back and forth struggle, which at first starts very innocently, pranks. Again, that's an old Clever Jack trick. Jack T trick, as like I like to call him.
Spring-heeled Jack.
It's the Spring-heeled Jack of Christian comics. And we're seeing the ramping up. You start by playing a game of D&D, and then before you know it, you're doing blood sacrifices. Guess what Elrond does? Elrond picks up a knife and attempts to stab his roommate to death. To sacrifice him to the game lords. And that's when it hit me. DOA is a fighting game. Now, it has a story mode, but predominantly, aren't you gonna... If your friend was like, hey, I'm home, wouldn't you say, pick up a controller, let's play? And so is Fight Night. See, that's when this started coming together. I was like, the person who wrote this hasn't played games. No, the person who wrote this doesn't dare touch games for fear of being corrupted. So he gives a cursory glance to a Game Informer and then quickly averts his eyes before he sees any saucy advertisements with women committing bestiality with Crash Bandicoot. More satanic imagery. And the joke, or lack of a joke, really, is that the girlfriend walks in. They're not married, but they share a bed. The girlfriend walks in and says, hey guys, are you done with the TV? I want to play Halo. And they both look shocked. Now, someone walks in and says, let's play Halo? Why is that a problem? That's actually a game that's up to 4 players. So they should all go, oh, okay.
You know who the 4th player would be?
Who?
Jesus.
No. Satan. Hey, I want to introduce you. We got a 4th controller here. You know, we're going to play some classic team deathmatch or capture the flag. Oh, what's his name? Black Phillip. Black Phillip wants to play. Except now he's a robot with a large X. Andy, what is a crucifix on its side as if it was tipped over?
Oh my God.
It's an X. That robot is the devil. His eyes are green. You know what else the devil or the Antichrist was green? The movie Prince of Darkness. You know what? Oh my goodness. Prince of Darkness. That's another word for the devil. Prince of Darkness is about the devil. Therefore, Ctrl+Alt+Del is about the devil. And here's some more proof, Andy.
Oh, no.
How much does a video game for the Xbox 360 cost?
$59.99.
Flip that upside down. That's 666 and then a made-up symbol, which you can just get out of there. Doesn't mean anything. That's three sixes. However, what is $59.99 after tax? $66.60 in some areas. But some areas, Sumeria, home of Baphomet, Samael, Lucifer, Beelzebub, he who cavorted with Lilith to create the race of demons. And if you're wondering, are there more satanic things that happen in this show? Well, what about fornication? What about bestiality? Andy, you noticed something in the very beginning of the show, didn't you?
A man pulls an innocent penguin into a room, and we don't know what he does with it, but...
He's looking, like, very shady as he slams a door when that penguin walks into a steel-bolted room. That, my friend, is bestiality. What if I told you that the robot, who we've already proven beyond a shadow of a doubt is the devil, makes that same penguin don a grass skirt and dance for his amusement while he plays the ukulele? Who wears grass skirts and dance around? Pagans. So he's making his sex penguin, dance for his amusement before he probably defiles him. This all culminates in an episode where the power goes off. It's a two-parter, because I'm assuming this is the last part you're supposed to see, and it shows how society breaks down. When Orville can't get to his gaming console, he reverts to a savage, like someone pre-Christian. He starts threatening his girlfriend with decapitation. He starts talking about a coming of a new age. It's all very, very creepy stuff. And then he plays an N-gage as if he's engaging with dark sorcery. So, Time Daily warned us about this. I mean, what are your thoughts on this show?
I think that Bum Tickley has really kind of created the perfect cautionary tale about gamer culture and about the evil that games can exhibit upon man.
Oh, yes. This is a deterrent. I am returning all my video games. I don't think I can handle this anymore. Now that I see where it can lead, I was once a skeptic. Now I'm saved.
But if we return them, someone else more impressionable than
That's
us.
That's true.
What if we return them, but we put chick tracks in the game manuals to teach people the word of the Lord?
That's why I keep finding chick tracks at the GameStop at the mall.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my goodness. Do you think this is the work of the creator?
Oh, Bucktide Russell?
Yeah. It must be. You know, people online make fun of him, but you know, all the greatest geniuses of our time. You know who else was made fun of relentlessly?
Who?
Jesus Christ. Hey, turn my water into wine, you goof. You dumb idiot. You know, he did it in song, which was extra. He wasn't taking this seriously whatsoever, but it's a catchy tune. I'll give it that. And probably the best, you know, probably the best best psalm out of the Bible. But, I mean, this is hard to watch, but the truth is always hard. You don't want to hear it. You don't want to know that Mario is the wolf among the sheep.
Wait a minute. The wolf among us for Xbox 360, PS3, and PC from Telltale Games?
Wait a minute. Xbox 360, triple sixes again.
D, demon. Xbox 360 demon.
So it's a no for me.
Yeah, it was very convincing, but it was still really bad.
I mean, I'm sorry. If I can't get at least 12 hours of Farmville, I'm just a crank to be around. So
let's go play some Angry Birds.
Yeah, sorry, Turd Burgley, but this just isn't my bag. Jack T. Chick actually passed away in late October, but we initially recorded this in mid-September, so no disrespect was intended. And I'd just like to say, Jack, R.I.H., rot in hell, you homophobic, xenophobic, fear-mongering, satanic, panic-spreading piece of shit. And to the creators of the Ctrl+Alt+Del web series, all that stuff I said was just a goof, it's a gag, it wasn't meant to be taken seriously. But I do have one major gripe. The Swedish chef is not a fucking marionette, he's a goddamn puppet. You know, as in Muppet-style puppet. Sure hope someone got fired for that one. So our last film is The Elm-Chanted Forest, and Gerald said he saw this on Toon Disney as a kid. I'm going to say bullshit to that. Disney would not associate with this terrible, terrible animated product. It's not, I take it back, it's not terrible. It's confusing on so many different layers. The amount of logic or lack thereof is baffling. It takes place in the Elm-Chanted Forest underneath the magic elm that protects all the forest creatures, but there's also a dark power that only wants to destroy, and it specifically hates beavers because beavers build.
Beaver, did you say beaver? Toothpick, did I not order all beavers executed?
You think that it would like beavers because beavers build by destroying the forest.
And they must have conflicting emotions on Andrew WK, who builds. Technically, not a cartoon reference, but it's on Cartoon Network.
I doubt this was ever on Cartoon Network also. No one wants to show this shit. We're introduced to the story through Baron Burr. And first off, Baron Burr, calm the fuck down. Get out of my face. You're coming on really aggressive. Also, one, why is your name a pun on Aaron Burr?
This was actually written by Lin-Manuel Miranda.
I rescind that point then. But two, Lin, why did you make him Sonic the Hedgehog? He's supposed to be in a different animated movie we were talking about.
He's basically a fusion of the Lorax and Sonic.
He's Sonic the Lorax. Pretty much Baron Burr's arch enemy is the smoke monster from Lost, who is in the employ of a juggalo homie. What? Look at that face. The dude's a juggalo, man. Welcome to the Dark Carnival. He's got his fucking axes dancing around. His fucking sentient halberds.
That's true. They're not quite hatchet men, but...
There are hatchet men, Andy. There are literal hatchet men. Juggalo homies. So 0 out of 10. Thanks for watching Bad Toon. Our hero is Painter Pete, Post Pot Pete, some shit like that.
Drivey Pete.
He's a man who falls asleep under the Elm-Chanted Forest, and he gets a magic ability where he can paint. Well, first, he can talk to animals, which he's like, what the fuck? These animals are talking, dude. Secondly,
Why does he talk like Jack Black?
Secondly, he can paint anything, and photorealistically, it comes to life. And then literally comes to life. His paintings have motion to them.
It's like an animated GIF. It's like the sprays that you can make in like Counter-Strike that animate, but in a cartoon.
There's a great scene where Painty Pete goes to Two Fort and he tricks the enemy sniper by spraying a decal of a spy on one of the far walls. It's actually the best scene in the entire movie.
And he spray paints boobs, and then he gets banned because no pornography, no gore.
He keeps putting up Lemon Party over and over again.
And then he's not in the movie anymore because he's banned. Just gone. He gets completely banned.
He gets VLC banned from the game, and the other characters just kind of stand around like, what do we do now? And also, there's a glitch. The Lemon Party thing's back, and it's bigger than ever.
It's VIC.
I said VLC banned?
Yeah, he said VLC.
I wish this movie was VLC banned. Ooh, then we wouldn't have to watch it.
Damn.
No, we'd still have Windows Movie Viewer.
Nobody uses that shit.
That's true.
It's like Internet Explorer. You just use it to get another one.
They fill Paste Pot Pete on the details. They're like, hey, King Spiny or whatever the fuck his name is. Violent J.
King Scaly.
He's fucking up the forest. And he says, hey, sign says, stay away, fools. Because love rules.
I know that love rules here.
I have a new name for this movie. I want to call it Shitty Wizards. Because it feels... I say this all the time, and people, I apologize. I don't want you thinking I'm some guy who's, like, obsessive compulsive, and I only watch one animator. But it feels like a Ralph Bakshi. But it doesn't feel like a Wizards. It feels like a Cool World. Or something he would have done, like, for Terry Toons, back when he worked at Terry Toons. The animation style, even though I believe this is a foreign film, it's very reminiscent of early Merry Melodies. The way characters are drawn and animated. This dude has his power. He starts making friends with the animals because he's painting gifts for them that they can then import. And that's when we meet the femme fatale fox.
Oh, God.
Why do animators want us to fuck animals so much?
And it's always foxes.
Because they're foxy. That's where we get the term.
Yeah, and vixen. Isn't a vixen a female fox?
I believe so, yes.
Yeah.
And we know this because Jimi Hendrix wrote Foxy Lady famously after he fucked that fox. But in his defense, it was a nine-tailed fox that took the guise of a human woman.
Some say Jimi Hendrix is still living amongst us today, but with a human disguise.
Well, people talk
That's
about...
That's the end of Pompoko. Jimi Hendrix turns into just a businessman and is like, don't tell anybody.
Wink. Well, people talk about Jimi Hendrix's famously enormous genitals. I just assume they meant his testicles.
The raccoon pouch.
His raccoon pouch, which he could fly on like a magic carpet.
Mm-hmm.
Or use as a rug, much to the chagrin of his house guests.
Or turn it into a bridge, and then, like, cars would roll over it, and then he'd yank it out and just fucking kill those
what
people?
What instrument did Jimi Hendrix play? What was he? He was a famous... Those large drums you hit with the mallets, right?
A taiko drum.
Yeah, he was a taiko drummer. I'd say he was a taiko drum master. Ha-cha, hey-cha-la.
A famous Jimi Hendrix song. If this is your first podcast, I apologize. We're being very confusing.
King Thistle or King Spiny has a...
King Prick. He kept using puns on being pointy.
He kept using the same puns. Yeah. Let's roll them out right now.
You pinheaded bird, my appointed wizard. Once again, I am cut to the quick. Come to the point. Look sharp, Thistle. Pinhead!
There they were. Now imagine that 15 more times.
Now, not once did he call someone a prick, which would have made this the perfect movie.
That should have been the ending line, as Paste Pot Pete says, you're a fucking prick.
And he's like, oh, you got it! Oh! And
then he stone cold stuns him.
It's the director's cut.
But he has a sidekick named Thistle, who's a wizard, who he sends off to destroy Painty Pete. And there's a recurring theme where King Spiny, he can't do his own dirty work. He has to get someone else to do it. So they first try and gain the allegiance of this bear, who's a football player. He has a thorn stuck in his paw. They remove the thorn, and he's indebted to the wizard, the shitty wizard, and then says, hey, I'm going to teach you to play football. And then we cut to the next scene. It's like, what? Why the fuck... Is this really going to be a plot point in the movie? Is that the luckily it isn't. Instead, they go to a bar and get drunk together. And there's this scene.
This is football, right? Getting hammered.
It's a part of football.
Maybe he just watches football because I think every watching party of football, that's all they do.
But there's a hoedown in this bar, and they try and teach this shitty wizard a song to liven his spirits. And so the bear and the attractive fox, they start dancing around. Let me talk more about this bear for a second. He's not colored like a regular bear. Andy, what bear is he? He is pink with purple spots.
He is Lotso from Toy Story 3.
I'm Lotso Huggin' Bear, but please call me Lotso.
Not Great Bear, son. Buddy Bear. That's great enough.
It's a good answer. It's a good answer. I was going to say he's the Woolly What's-It from Teddy Ruxpin. Now, back at the bar, they're having a hoedown. They're playing jugs and banjos and an old-timey piano, and it reminds me a lot of the old cartoon Kissy Fur. But Kissy Fur, more like Kiss My Ass. Woolly What's-It, more like Woolly What the Fuck Am I Watching?
Your favorite show, Teddy Ruxpin.
The Raccoons, more like garbage. Anyway, they seduce the wizard and they get him drunk, and now he's on their side.
They seduce him?
I think they seduce him. He's flying around with hearts, and there's a sexy fox talking about letting his hair down to have fun. Now, letting your hair down to us doesn't imply anything sexual, but when you're completely covered in hair, to me that sounds like an invite to Lapland. There's a trend in this movie where it is a musical, and only the most inconsequential characters have songs. It starts off with them singing a song to seduce the wizard, where Painty Pete is nowhere to be found, and he has no idea what's happened in this scene. He is so far removed. He's painting pictures of the kids from Sonic Underground in a completely different scene, but yet he's still the protagonist. Not the bear who plays football and makes football puns, not the shitty wizard, but, you know, paint guy. The other song comes in the form of this frog king who's going to sleep, and the frogs have to sing him to sleep.
And it comes out of nowhere.
And it goes on forever.
Yeah.
But then when he goes to sleep, his subconscious is transferred to an ethereal realm, and he goes to the palace from Beauty Warrior. We have our first Bad Toons crossover. It all makes sense. They even hint at a stalactite fight, but luckily that shit's ignored. So down in Gaither's Pond, essentially, oh, another crossover, King Spiny is trying to confuse the Frog King into destroying the Elm-Chanted Forest for him. And the Frog King has a never-ending bucket, a never-ending keg that when he pulls the cork out of, water comes out and it doesn't stop. Which I believe that's kind of like a mythological thing, right?
Yeah.
Like, you see that a lot.
It's a video game thing. There's a lot of video games where that kind of shit happens.
But, like, you see that in, like, Japanese mythology or, I believe, Norwegian mythology. Wasn't there a horn that contained a river? And, like, it never stopped flooding until it was dammed?
Yeah, I think the Japanese one is actually an endless gust, like endless wind.
So the River King, River City Ransom, holds up this bucket. He holds up Mr. Bucket, and the water comes rushing out, and Painty Pete uses his magic brush to make the sun come out, and it dries up all the rain.
Yeah.
From a never-ending source of water that is...
It's a never-ending source of sun.
That's true.
And when it does end, it's not going to matter how much water there is.
Yeah, that's true.
Because you're all fucking dead.
We've been dead for a long time. The gamma rays released from a dying star would have irradiated this planet.
But.
Which is what happens. Oh my god. Painty Pete killed everyone else in the world. The other animals were safe because the Elm-Chanted Forest, but we don't have those magic elms everywhere. There's two of them. There's one in the Elm-Chanted Forest. There's the White Tree of Gondor. Everyone else is dead. This is the precursor to Lord of the Rings. Or wizards.
Or both.
We thought that five terrorist cells set off five nuclear missiles, but no. It was some asshole from Kirby 64 with a magic paintbrush who fucked the world up. They get to the point where it turns out Painty Pete is going to lose his powers.
For some reason.
For some reason. when the sun rises. So they have to defeat the king that night. And you're thinking, awesome, the movie's going to end. They throw in two additional subplots. One with some vaguely racist mushrooms that have a pseudo rap number, kind of. There's breakdancing. It's like a country that's never heard rap thinking, like, this is what rap sounds like, right? But there is breakdancing. When they approach the shitty wizard who's still in the bar, holy shit, they're getting him nice and liquored up. And they're like, hey, what's up with King Cactus? Why is he such a prick? Why is he an asshole? That wasn't a pun. I personally think he's an asshole.
The wizard, asshole is not a pun on Cactus, Chris. I don't know what you're thinking.
The wizard relays to him this prophecy. And we've heard this prophecy throughout the movie. In fact, Aaron Burr... What was his name? Baron Burr tells the King Cactus this prophecy in the beginning, and it's his only motivation for trying to destroy the Elm-Chanted Forest. And the prophecy goes like this.
It is the prophecy. No man may rule of cactus taint until the forest runs with paint. But when it comes, that dreaded hour... the hopes of Cactus King will flower.
Say what?
The Emperor thinks that Peter's coming will end his rule.
What about the part that says his hopes will flower?
I don't know.
Do you know that cactus plants sometimes have the blossoms?
Fifi is right. Thistle, has the Cactus King ever had flowers on his body?
No, never.
This could be it. Spine is angry and mean because he's frustrated. He's never fulfilled his nature.
Whoa there, son. Then all we got to do is make flowers grow on him. That's it.
And then the painty guy, Paint Pete, says, oh, that's why he's so frustrated. He hasn't fulfilled his purpose. And for some reason, the way he says it, I just think, that's why he's so frustrated. He's a virgin. We gotta pop this cactus's cherry, if you know what I mean. Oh, it's also a woman. So they make a potion or some shit, and they go to deliver it to the Cactus King. And you point out that it's kind of disturbing, because there's a big fight between the sentient hatchets, the hatchet men. The fox uses her feminine wiles to beguile humanoid creatures into thinking they're gonna fuck her, and then when they go behind a bush, they get beaten up. But the Cactus King's asleep, and the paint guy sneaks up on him and force feeds him this potion, which turns them all rainbow colored, and the room becomes rainbow colored, and flowers bloom everywhere. And I'm like, oh my god, they defeated him with the gay agenda.
There were rumors of building a gay bomb and having to try and pinpoint exactly what makes a person homosexual. And I believe that it was around this time they made a potion in the Elm-Chanted Forest that could turn a cactus gay or something. But I don't know.
But that's the good thing, though, Andy, is, yeah, there is a gay agenda. There are people out there who are trying to turn people gay. But it works for the better of society. That's the whole message of this movie, is this man is so uptight because he hasn't fulfilled his purpose. He hasn't bloomed.
That's why he's a virgin.
They slip him a Mickey. He turns into a bunch of flowers. And suddenly, the world has no more conflict.
So, make gay people your king, and there will be peace.
Well, I think that what it's saying is homosexuality is a choice, but it's the right choice.
And it's the choice of a new generation.
It's the right choice for the right future. Vote yes on Prop 1231. By the way, we're kidding. If you are a homosexual person, or someone who's genderqueer, or someone who is non-binary, these are just... What is this called? Is this like an instapology? Like, there has to be a term for this where we make really crude, mean jokes and then go, hey, please don't take it personally. We're just kidding. We're on your side.
And this isn't like us, like, a week later on Twitter or something going like, God, you know, my image is going to be wrecked if I don't, you know, say this joke is bad or something. This is... We edit this.
Yeah, so it's not live. I can edit this whole thing out. This is not live. I'm choosing not to, because if you've listened to anything we've made in the past, you know we're just kidding.
Yeah.
But if this is your first episode, we're just kidding.
It gets better if you turn a cactus man into a flower.
It gets better if you're force-fed a potion while you sleep. Maybe they were just getting him liquored up. Maybe they were just getting him so drunk that, like, he opens, like, emotionally opens up to them.
The fucking message of this movie, because remember, there's a scene where the bear drinks the potion and he gets hungover. Bud E. Bear, or whatever the fuck his name is, he gets drunk. The whole message of this movie, get the shitty wizard drunk, get the bear drunk, get the king drunk. It's just, get drunk, get hammered, don't worry about life, whatever.
But it's alcohol makes you emotionally available. It lets you let your fucking hair down.
When you're feeling kind of lonely and all bottled up inside. When your little heart is breaking from the feelings that you hide. There's a place that you are welcome where your little heart can mend. Come with me and let your fur down with a friend.
Yeah.
And then tell your parents, preferably at Thanksgiving, hey, I'm going to make this a gay kingdom now. I'm not about knocking down trees. I'm about building carousels, and there's shit you can do about it.
Or if you want to say, hey, I'm going to fuck this fox? I don't know.
Hey, Dad, you're the real prick. Fuck you for not accepting me.
Does he have a dad? He's a cactus.
He's a cactus dad. Cactus Jack.
Cactus Jack is his dad. But then Mick Foley would be accepted.
But then Mick Foley would be like, why would you, of all wrestlers in history, why would you assume I'm the homophobic
because
one?
You're the only one who's my dad, Dad.
And then Cactus Jack takes his shirt off, and he's Dude Love, and he's like, we're both colorful weirdos now. I love you, Dewey. I mean, King Cactus Man. I saw, when we were getting ready to record this, I saw a sign from one of our fans. And it said, Kane King Cactus Man. King Cactus Man is 8 months old. You sick sons of bitches! You took everything from me! So, this is a weird movie. Do not watch alone. You will not find enjoyment. But I'd watch it with some friends. There's a lot to make fun of. There's a lot of weird scenes to poke fun at. Oh, we forgot to mention the beaver, who's like the sidekick of the main character, is named J. Edgar Beaver.
Yeah, and at one point they say he has beaver fever.
Ah, I shall call it beaver fever. Hot butter cakes. A beast in the bush.
There's a beast in the bush, and that beast is beaver fever. Oh my god, the Cactus King hates beavers!
Oh my god!
Oh my god! But at the very end, he's fine with beavers. They're not his thing, but he's cool with them. It's like,
he's not gonna yuck any yums.
But he's like, hey, I don't have this irrational fear of them anymore because I'm more accepting of who I am. So if you want to be a lesbian, go ahead.
If you've got beaver fever.
If you have two beavers to rub together, I won't stop you. We would like to take this time to apologize.
This is a...
Our previous apology wasn't good enough. Yeah, I'm sorry we said those things. I know we said we would stop making jokes about homosexual relationships, but we didn't. And I just want to say from the bottom of my heart, I apologize. So now it's time for your favorite part of the show. It's Chris Recommends. Now, we've talked about some cartoons that were terrible, Ctrl+Alt+Del, ones that are okay if you watch with the group, Elm-Chanted Forest, and ones that were just laughably bad, Ratatouille. You know, a weird movie made with a very low budget that had a terrible cast. People like real nobodies. Lisa Ortiz, Mike Pollock, Dan Green. Like, these names don't jump out at me or anything. Let's talk about some great animated products that have some real talent behind it. So I'm going to suggest a few things. First off, Sonic X. Great cartoon, great cast, people like Lisa Ortiz, Mike Pollock, Dan Green, really knocking it out of the park. Another classic, a classic anime you people might remember from your youth, Yu-Gi-Oh!, that great card battling anime. Great cast as well, people like Lisa Ortiz, Mike Pollock, Dan Green. And then, of course, for the older crowd, titty animes. You know, animes that star big-breasted women. So, voice actors like Lisa Ortiz, Mike Pollock, and Dan Green. So those are my suggestions.
I don't have the guts to watch those animes. I feel like they'd make me go berserk.
So I'm noticing a lot of these, the credits on these people. There's some saucy animes, but some of them look like they're straight up hentais.
More like Howl's Throbbing Asshole.
More like Princess Mononoke.
More like Gay 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 No Kitaro.
More like Secret Life of Areola.
More like Secret Life of Harry Titty.
Full Metal Alchemist. More like Full Metal Anal Fist.
More like JoJo's Jizzar Adventure.
Space Adventure Cobra. More like Space Adventure No Bra.
Hakuto no Ken. More like Fist Me Up the North Star.
Ozumatsu-kun, more like Oh My Massive Cunt.
Death Note, more like Deep Throat.
Gigantor, more like His Gigantic Cock Tore Open My Asshole.
IGPX, more like I Love Gay Sex.
Initial D, more like Initial D's Nuts.
Captain Harlock, more like Captain Hardcock.
Cowboy Bebop, more like Cowboy Shebop.
Cowboy Bebop, more like Cowboy Rocksteady.
Disgaea, more like This Guy Over Here Won't Stop Fucking Me In My Mouth.
Papua, more like Papa Cherry.
Cherry Poppin' Daddies, more like Cherry Poppin' Grandpas, cause they're fucking old.
Did we already say the most obvious one?
What one?
Sonic X, more like Sonic Gex? No wait, Sex! Sex! Damn it! One Punch Man, more like One Crunch Can. This podcast is brought to you in part by Pringles.
Generator Rex, more like Generator Gex.
God damn it. God damn it. I thought you were...